thank you for the introduction. Well, let's start. Can you guys hear me okay? Lovely. So today I want to talk about advanced ingress for your Kubernetes apps. This is NGINX. So, and here's our agenda. So first I will start with defining the problem. What is ingress load balancing on Kubernetes? Then I present you the solution to this problem of ingress controller, and specifically NGINX ingress controller. And I'll show you two ways to configure load balancing using the ingress controller. The first way is to use the standard regular Kubernetes ingress resources. And the alternative way is to use the custom resources that we developed, NGINX ingress resources. And I will compare the two approaches and show you how they work. And in the end, we also will see the demos. Well, not at the end, actually, all the way through my talk, you will see the demos. I know we have 50 minutes for this session. It will probably be shorter than that. So let's start. Before I start, I'd like to understand better the audience we have here. So does anybody run Kubernetes? Does anybody deploy applications on Kubernetes? So seems like most of people are familiar. So let's imagine we have a Kubernetes cluster, and it's represented by this gray rectangle on the screen. And I want to deploy a web application on Kubernetes. So what did I do? I create a deployment on Kubernetes. And I tell Kubernetes to run two replicas of my application. So Kubernetes launches two pods of my application. Then the next step will be to make those pods discoverable inside the cluster. So for that, I create a service. Okay, so we have the pods, we have the service. So now I have my application running inside my cluster. Now I want to deliver this application to my clients, my users, over the internet. So what do I do? So Kubernetes comes with an ingress resource or ingress object. And this is essentially in a Kubernetes API to configure a load balancer. Well, layer 7 load balancer, or we can layer 7 proxy. So to expose my web applications to my users, my clients, I create an ingress resource. And as a result, a layer 7 load balancer will be provisioned. And through that layer 7 load balancer, my clients will get access to my web application. So let's take a look closely at this ingress resource. So this is how it looks like. So on Kubernetes, every Kubernetes object it can be represented by YAML. So this is a YAML manifest for the ingress resource. So we have a standard kind, metadata, and name fields. And then we have load balancing configuration. So what do we have here? So here we define one rule. So we want to route user request with the host header webapp.example.com and with the path slash. So we want to route such requests to our web application. So that's what this ingress resource defines. And so the next step is to apply this ingress resource to the load balancer. So how can we do that? So there is a component, it's called ingress controller. And this component is, the task of this component is to convert the ingress configuration into the configuration of a particular load balancer. And this can be hardware or software load balancer. It can also be a cloud load balancer. But the main point is that the ingress controller basically converts the ingress resources that users, Kubernetes users deploy, and converts them into the load balancer configuration and applies that configuration. So ingress controller is a special software, and this software talks to the Kubernetes API to get the ingress resources that the users deploy. And then, as I said, it configures a load balancer. And it does it in a loop. So every time a new ingress resource is deployed or an existing one is changed, the ingress controller will ensure that the load balancer stays reconfigured. So there are Ingress controllers for different load balancers, for NGINX, for, you know, for F5, big IP, for HAProxy, for Google Cloud load balancer. So we have developed the Ingress controller for NGINX, and so with NGINX, this is like a high-level architecture. So the Ingress controller is deployed in Kubernetes in a pod, and it's deployed alongside of NGINX. So NGINX and Ingress controller, they run inside the same container. But the mechanics of how Ingress controller this Ingress controller works are the same as the one I just described. So it talks to the Kubernetes API, then generates NGINX configuration, and then applies that configuration to NGINX. So, however, there is a difference. Because we are running NGINX inside the Kubernetes, we need to expose NGINX itself to the clients outside of the cluster. And so the way to do it is we need to create a service for our Ingress controller, and then we can expose this service through a layer three or layer four load balancer. So for example, if you run your Kubernetes cluster in the cloud, you can create a service with a type load balancer, and the Kubernetes will provision a layer three or layer four load balancer for you for that service. So as a result, in our key diagram here, the clients, the users that we want to expose, you know, our web application, so they can, the first thing they access, they send a request to this layer three, layer four load balancer, and then from that load balancer sends the traffic to the Ingress controller, and then from the Ingress controller in turn sends the traffic to our backend pods. Okay, any questions so far? Okay, so the Ingress controller is a, you know, general component of Kubernetes, and as I said, there are different Ingress controllers for different load balancers. So to resume, the purpose of the Ingress controller is to provide external load balancing for HTTP load balancing for applications that you run in your cluster. And with our NGINX Ingress controller, so we can add additional, you know, goals. So as you know, NGINX is a software load balancer. It's been around 3 years now, so it's a mature project. It is fast, it is reliable, it's secure. So we want to bring this, you know, NGINX load balancing to the Kubernetes users. Kubernetes has a rich ecosystem, so there are other tools that gain adoption on Kubernetes, such as Prometheus, Helm, OpenTracing. So we want our NGINX Ingress controller also to be integrated with the Kubernetes, you know, ecosystem. So not only it provides load balancing, but it also integrates with the Kubernetes ecosystem. So, and just to clarify any confusion, well, there are two popular NGINX Ingress controllers. There's one that we have developed, and I will be talking about our Ingress controller, and there's the one that developed by Kubernetes community, and it's hosted on Kubernetes GitHub. So in this talk, we will talk about our Ingress controller that we have developed. And let me show you the first demo right away. So I show you, well, how the Ingress resource in action. So we will configure load balancing for a simple web application. I have a Kubernetes cluster running in the cloud, in Google Cloud. And as you can see, I run kubectl get nodes command. So you see that I have three nodes in my cluster. I also deployed the Ingress controller, NGINX Ingress controller. Let me show it to you. So I'll show you the pods and the services of the Ingress controller. And the Ingress controller is deployed in the namespace NGINX Ingress. So we have the pod here, So we have one pod, and we have the service that we use to expose the Ingress controller to the outside of the cluster. And this service provisioned, Kubernetes provisioned the cloud load balancer for us with this external IP. So if we try to hit it with Perl, we will get a not found from our NGINX Ingress controller. So next, I already deployed a few applications. So if I run kubectl get pod and service, you will see that in default namespace, I have multiple pods. So I have two coffee pods running. So those pods are simple web applications named coffee. There are also another two pods, coffee decaf. So those are web application. They represent the decaf coffee web application. Again, it's very simple. And I also have one teapot. Again, it's a simple web application. So they're all running in default namespace, and for each application I have I created a service as well. So now I want to expose those applications, you know, to the internet. So for that I built through our Ingress controller. So for that I will show you the Ingress resource that I will use. And this is the Ingress resource. So what do we have here? Well, the first thing is we define TLS termination. So our application will be represented by this hostname, cafe-example.com. So for this hostname, we define, we configure TLS termination, and we specify a secret to use for TLS termination. So on Kubernetes, you can also deploy another resource called secret, and you can store your TLS certificate and key for that particular domain, and then secret. So here we just reference it. So we configure TLS termination, now we configure load balancing rules. So we have one rule for the host cafe caching example.com, and we have two paths. So let me show them to you. So all the requests that start with slash T, URI, will be load balanced to the ports of the T service, and all requests that starts with slash coffee URI will be load balanced to the port of the coffee service. So this is, well, not sophisticated load balancing configuration. It's just TLS termination and path-based routing. So let's apply this resource. Let's deploy this resource on Kubernetes. And behind the scene, the NGINX Ingress controller reconfigured NGINX to apply this configuration. So let's try to access our applications. So here we have cafe-ingress-example.com/coffee. Let's try to refresh it. So as you can see, I refresh each time, since we have two coffee pods, each time we get a response from a different pod. So they have from either of two. And as you remember, I also configured the T path, so I can also try to get T. Okay. So let's go back to our presentation. So I showed you the standard Kubernetes Ingress resource, and we used it to expose our cafe applications to the internet. So let's talk about the limitations of the Ingress resource. And there are two main limitations: the lack of features and the lack of cross namespace configuration. So let's talk about them. So what do I mean by lack of features? So Ingress resource, well, can only support two main features: well, TLS termination, so request routing based on the host header, and request routing based on the URI of the request. So those are the only things. Advanced routing, things like authentication or rate limiting, those things are not supported. There is a way though to extend the Ingress resource so that some of the features can still be supported. Or it's not necessarily even can be a feature, but just the customization of load balancing configuration. Like, for example, how can we choose a different load balancing method? So on Kubernetes, every resource can be on an agent. And by that I mean, so every resource, well, Ingress resource or any other type of resource, has a metadata field called annotations. And those annotations allows you to specify key value string pairs. So our Ingress controller understands certain annotations. And so when it sees an annotation, it will apply that annotation to the generated config. So for example, here we want to change the load balancing method from the default to the IP hash method available at NGINX. So with this method, NGINX will send the request from the same client represented by the IP address. It will ensure that requests from the same client are sent to the same backend service. So this is how we configure that. So we use a special annotation, NGINX or LBAM method, and we specify the load balancing algorithm. And our Ingress controller has a number of annotations that allow you to either customize its behavior, so things like load balancing methods, timeouts, or use advanced features. For example, use authentication. But those are not part of the Ingress resource. Those are the extensions that could be added on top of it. So let's talk about good and bad things about annotation. So using annotation, so annotations allows us to customize configuration, and they also implement features that are not available with a standard Ingress configuration. However, there are bad things as well. So this one was not a real world example. This is an example of how annotations are used in real world. You would typically use more than one. And as you can see, this map of annotation can grow quickly, and it can actually grow bigger than the spec, bigger than the load balancing configuration that you define. So here, for example, we define the load balancing method. We enable TLS for connections between NGINX and backend pods, configure timeouts, and authentication. So annotations can grow bigger than spec. Annotations also lack validation. So they are just key value string pairs. They are not, there is no types here. They're just key value strings. And they're not suited for granular configuration. So the load balancing method that we choose here, for example, it will be applied for every service that we expose through this Ingress resource. So you cannot apply it granularly per particular service. And not portable. So not portable across the Ingress controllers because it's not part of the spec. So those annotations are typically vendor specific. So if you want to change the Ingress controller, you also need to change the annotations that you use. So I told you about the first limitations. So Ingress, the Ingress is just limited in features it supports. But another limitation is cross namespace configuration. So what do I mean by that? So Kubernetes cluster can be separated into namespaces, so that multiple teams can use one cluster at the same time. And most of the resources that you create on Kubernetes, resources like deployments, pods, or Ingress, they are namespaces. So they belong to a specific namespace. So let's imagine this situation where we want to expose our Cafe application that I showed you previously in the demo. But let's imagine this situation where we have two teams. There is a Coffee team and there's a Tea team. And they all, both teams, they run their corresponding applications in their own namespace. And we want to create a load balancing configuration that exposes both Coffee and Tea services under the same hostname, but when the Coffee and Tea services, they are in a different namespace. So can we do that? Well, the Ingress resource doesn't support that. So with NGINX Ingress controller, we try to address this limitation. So we introduce a concept called mergeable Ingress resources. And here how it works. So we split this ingress resource to three ingress resources. So please bear with me. So first we will have mergeable master. So the mergeable master ingress resource is represented by the annotation mergeable ingress type equals master. So here, as you can see, we will deploy it in a special cafe namespace. So we have coffee namespace, key namespace, and here we deploy this ingress resource into its own cafe namespace. And this ingress resource only defines the master, the host base router. So we create this mergeable master for a specific host. So the next step is to create mergeable minions. So minions cannot exist without master. So first you need to create a master, and then you create minions. So with minions are represented by the annotations mergeable ingress type equal minion. So here we create a coffee minion, and in a coffee namespace where the coffee application runs. And so the minion must have the same host as the master. So here it's cafe.example.com. And this minion has routing configuration for the coffee application. So requests that start with the URI /coffee allot balance to the coffee service. So the same thing we apply to the T application. So we created a minion for the T application. So we created in the T namespace. Again, the same thing. The host must be the same as a person master. And then we put the routing configuration for the T application here. So as a result, when we deploy the master ingress resource in the cafe namespace, the two minions, one in the coffee namespace and one in the T namespace, the ingress controller will merge those configurations together, and that's how we can you will able to access. That's how the user will be able to access this application, and that's how you can split the configuration across multiple namespaces. So back to the problem. So the standard ingress resource just doesn't support cross namespace configuration. However, if you in case of the NGINX Ingress Controller, we extended this ingress resource. So if we split your ingress resource into the master and minions, so you can split those ingress resources across multiple namespaces. So two major limitations of the ingress resource is lack of features and lack of the support for the cross namespace configuration. And so to address those, so I showed you how those limitations can be addressed using annotations. But there is another approach how we can address those limitations. And this is approach that we went with. So can we do better than that? So the approach is that we have developed our own ingress resources. So we defined our own YAML definitions that you can use if you use NGINX Ingress Controller. So Kubernetes allows you to add the resource types to the cluster on the fly, register or deregister. So we created our own resource definitions that you can register inside your cluster and start using. And those resources represent load balancing configuration. And those resources address the limitations that I just showed you. So let's look into them. This is the first resource that we developed. It's called virtual server, as you can see here by the kind field. And let's compare this resource to the standard ingress resource. So again, the API version is kind of different. And so this the virtual server on the left defines the same load balancing configuration as the ingress resource on the right. So here we define we define the host. So the host based routing rule. So we will expose our, we're exposing the application via webapp.example.com hostname, similar as we do in the Ingress resource. Then you can configure TLS termination by referencing a secret with a TLS certificate in a key. Well, similar, very similar, in a similar way that you can do in the Ingress resource. And then you can define routing rules. So here we have routing rules. So it's a similar routing rule. Request for the slash URI routed to the web application. So the only difference here right now is that you need to define a load balancing pool in case of the virtual server resource. So here, as you can see, we have the upstreams field where we define one upstream called web app, and this upstream references service, web app service. So on Kubernetes, in the Ingress resource, in a standard Ingress resource, you reference the service right away without defining the pool. So let me show you how it works in action. So I will deploy this Cafe virtual server, and then I just show it to you right away. So I deploy the virtual server, and let me show it to you. So we have the host cafe.example.com. We enable TLS termination here. We define two load balancing pool, one for the tea service and one for the coffee services, two upstreams, and here you can see the routing rules. So requests that start with T are routed to the T upstream. So for that we use the special action pass, and requests that starts with a coffee, request with a URI that starts with coffee, are routed to the coffee service. So we can test that. If we go to the browser, so this is the cafe.example.com/coffee. Well, if you try to refresh the page, we see that it works. It returns coffee. And if we change the URI to /t, we are routed to the t service. So that's our virtual server resource in action. Although, so this one defines very simple configuration, similar to the Ingress resource. But I was talking about the limitations of the Ingress resource. So let's see how the virtual server addresses those limitations. So first of all, remember I showed you this annotation for configuring load balancing in the Ingress resource. So in the virtual server resource, when you define an upstream, along the upstream definition, you can define the load balancing method that you want to apply for that upstream. So here we use the IP hash method, and in the upstream coffee, we use list connection load balancing method available in NGINX. And you can, when you define an upstream, you can also define connection timeouts, passive health checks, or active health check as well. And as you can see, this configuration belongs where it needs to be in a spec rather than adding it through annotation. What other limitations did we address? Traffic splitting. So what is traffic splitting? Imagine you have two versions of your service, and you want to, from NGINX, you want to route 90% of the requests to the first version, but the rest 10% to the second version. And this can be used if you want to do the canary releases. So the virtual server resource routing rules allow you to split the traffic among the multiple versions of the same application by using this splits field. So you can configure weights. So here we configure the traffic splitting. So 90% of the requests are routed to the version 1 and the rest of the 10 to version 2. So another feature that we bring in, we support is advanced routing. So what if you want to route most of the requests that has the cookie version equals version 2 to version 2 of your service, but all other requests that don't have this cookie to the first version of the service. Again, this is possible with our routing rules that we put in the virtual server. You can define the matches block, where you can define the conditions. So here we define one condition when we evaluate the cookie version and check if its value is v2. And if this condition succeeds, the request is routed to the version 2 of the service. And by default, it's routed to the version 1 of this service. So let me show you this demo, how this advanced routing rules work in action. Again, the first thing I will do is I will apply the configuration. So I'm updating the existing virtual server. And let me show it to you. So it looks here, it looks the same. We have the only thing we added additional load balancing pool, additional upstream coffee decaf for the decaf application that we're also running in the default namespace. And now let's look at the routing rules. So the basic routing rules I already showed you in the previous version. And here we have the split. So here we define a split where we route 50% of the request to the coffee service and another 50 to the coffee decaf service. So if I go back to my browser window and put coffee split here, so if I try to refresh this page, you would see that roughly 50% of the requests go to the coffee service and 50% to the decaf. Here we have another routing rules. So let's see. So here we route requests. Well, first of all, again, we do the prefix-based routing, but then we have a condition here when we evaluate the argument, URL argument choice, and if the choice is decaf, the request is routed to the decaf service. And by default, it will be routed to the coffee service. So let's try that connection again. Let's see the connection. So we have coffee argument prefix, and then, so you see, it was routed to the coffee service, and if we add the U argument, choice equals decaf, the request is routed to the decaf service. So let's see what else we have. So we also support routing based on regular expression. So if the request URI includes the latte, so here it's more interesting. So we don't route the request to the backend to any of the services. We configure NGINX to return a static response. So with our return action, you can configure a static response that NGINX can return. So if we put a latte here somewhere, you can see that we get a 404 response, no more lattes, sorry. And similarly, so one last request routing option is you can also route based on the exact match. So this means that request to URI must exactly be NGINX and nothing else. So in this case, we use another action type called redirect. So request is redirected to nginx.org. Let's try that. NGINX. So we got redirected, and we got redirected to nginx.org website. So those were advanced routing rules in action based on the header scoop. I showed you routing based on the URI argument, but you can also route based on the headers, on the cookies, on the request method. You can use regular expression, you can use exact matches. And you can also do traffic splitting. So another problem that we addressed is support for cross namespace configuration. So remember our example with Ingress resources. We have coffee team in the coffee namespace and tea team in the tea namespace, and they both run their applications in their own namespaces. So here we have we can define the virtual server in the cafe namespace. We can define TLS termination, as you can see here. But look here, when we define routes, So we don't specify the, you know, the action here. What we specify is another, the name of the, another resource where this particular route or coffee route is defined. And it's the same for T. So we delegate the definition of this particular routes to the resources in the different namespaces. So let's look into those resources. So along with the virtual server route resource, we also introduce virtual server. Along with the virtual server resource, we also introduce the virtual server route resource. So the virtual server route is slightly more limited than virtual server. It doesn't allow you to define the TLS termination or any other host level parameters. But it allows you to define the upstreams and routes. So this is the coffee route, or coffee virtual server route that we deploy. We deploy in the coffee namespace. So the host must be the same as the host in the virtual server route. That reference, no, the host must be the same as the host in the virtual server that references this virtual server route. So it's cafe.example.com. And here we define the subroutes. So remember, so the in virtual server resource we had a /path/coffee. So here we define this path. And we define the action for this path, so we route request to the coffee service. So the virtual server resource lives in the cafe namespace. This virtual server route lives in the coffee namespace, same namespace where we have the coffee application running. And similarly, we have a T virtual server route. So T virtual server route lives in the T namespace, and it defines, you know, routing. It defines routes/T. With an action to pass a such request to the T service. So in the end, so we have the virtual server, which defines the host level configuration for cafe.example.com. And in the virtual server, we delegate the configuration for the coffee route to the virtual server resource in a coffee namespace. And we also delegate the T definition for the T route to the virtual server route resource in the T namespace. So why is this important? So you can split the configuration load balancing configuration for your application across multiple namespaces. And so in this case, particular case, the admins in your cluster can deploy virtual servers, and then the users, so the coffee namespace team, can deploy the virtual server route to expose the, you know, coffee part of the coffee application under the /coffee part, and then the T team can deploy the virtual server route to expose the T application under the /T part. And using Kubernetes RBAC rules, you can restrict so that regular users such as coffee and T teams, they can only configure virtual server routes, and only admin can configure virtual servers. So to summarize the NGINX Ingress resources, so they're based on custom resources. So custom resources is a feature that allows you to add any new resource to the Kubernetes on the fly. And our NGINX Ingress resources supports advanced features that are missing in the Ingress resource, such as advanced routing rules and advanced customization options. And we also support, we better support cross namespace configuration. You might ask, I talked about exposing web application, operate on HTTP protocol. How about, you know, TCP traffic or UDP traffic? So right now we're working on adding new resources, again based on the custom resources, to support the TCP traffic represented here on the left. We will also support the UDP traffic and TLS pass-through traffic. So TLS pass-through traffic is routing connections, encrypted TCP TLS connections to the corresponding backend services without decrypting them. So those things are coming in our next release scheduled for March. And going forward, we would, so as I mentioned, support for TCP, UDP, and TLS pass-through. And going forward, we will also extend the NGINX Ingress resources, so the virtual server and virtual server route, to support more features, things like request response manipulations that would be, you know, adding or removing headers to the response or to the request, support for authentication options, you know, basic authentication, client certificate authentication, support for rate limiting, or so you can also use NGINX with web application firewalls, such as mode security. So we also want to bring support for that into the Ingress controller. So this is the end. So the Ingress controller project is open source. It's publicly available on GitHub, so you can try to use it and contribute. Use it if you can open issues, or if you want to contribute, you can submit a pull request. So with NGINX, we have two versions, NGINX open source and NGINX Plus. NGINX Plus is a commercial version, which comes with additional features and support contract. So our Ingress controller both works with NGINX open source and NGINX Plus. And the examples that I showed you in this presentation are based on the examples that we have in GitHub, on GitHub. So you can also see the examples on GitHub and try them out. So this is the end. I have time to answer. If you guys have any questions, I'm happy to answer. There's a question, yes? Yeah. We're going to pass you a microphone.
So how much can you get away with modern day people used to use like the F5 appliances? Uh-huh. Now that we've gone to the cloud, it just doesn't make sense anymore. So really, what would be the purpose of still having an F5 versus an NGINX cluster going on?
Mm-hmm. So with NGINX, in this controller, NGINX, you run it inside your cluster. So you run it in the port in a container. And NGINX exposes, you know, does layer 7 build. But then you still need to expose the NGINX Ingress controller to the outside of the cluster. And so if you running your Kubernetes in the cloud, So this is how I exposed the Ingress controller to the outside of the cluster, to the internet. I created a service of the type load balancer. And so my cluster is in Google Cloud, so Kubernetes provisioned the Google Cloud load balancer for you and give me this IP address. But if you're running inside your own data center, on your own infrastructure, you don't have this option. So Kubernetes cannot provision, there's no API, cloud load balancer API for you to be provisioned. But in this case, if you have your own data center, there's also the chances that the big chance you also have your F5 device there already in big IP. So this will definitely be a use case when it is, it's a suitable use case to use a big IP as a front-end load balancer, and then enhancing this control as a second-tier load balancer.
Does that answer your question? Wonderful. Thank you, Michael.
Hi. Could you share some differences between the NGINX as well as the traffic ingress?
Traffic?
Traffic. If you have done the analysis, what features does this NGINX ingress provide versus the traffic, which seems to be, I've come across it usage often in the Kubernetes world?
So I cannot provide you a kind of compressive comparison, but so with Ingress controller, the way you configure it is using the Ingress resource, and then you can use additional features through annotations. So both traffic and traffic in this controller, the NGINX in this controller support them. The difference comes, you know, what annotations we support. So I think they most of them should be the the same features. Probably some features that they support, some we don't support, and vice versa. And the second difference will be for support for I showed you the virtual server and virtual server route resources. So this is something new. So not every Ingress controller. Well, this is, first of all, this is our specific resources. So so they don't support it. But for us, we think that this new configuration allows you to use Ingress Controller to configure it for these advanced use cases, traffic splitting, advanced request routing, and we have also some plans to support authentication, rate limiting, and other policies. A comprehensive analysis I can provide you. I saw a few examples on the web. A few different people try to put like a table and compare all. They might not be as extensive. No, but it can show you like some high level analysis.
So you provided the cross namespace communication. How was this received in the Kubernetes community? Like, is cross namespace communication by Ingress encouraged, or it's kind of like seen as something that you should use cautiously? Because namespace is like a control for production or some kind of like access control mechanism in Kubernetes. So
the standard Ingress resource doesn't support cross namespace, but the Ingress controllers try to support it, and typically it will be like by merging the Ingress resources that have the host name. So if you have the Ingress resource with the same host name in different namespaces, the Ingress controllers will try to merge them into one Ingress resource, and then essentially generate load balancing configuration from that point. So with our Ingress controller, we tried to make it more explicit. So that's why we introduced the concept of this mergeable Ingress resources, the masters and minions. So this explicitness it's meant to prevent people from making mistakes. So from customers and users, I see that the adoption, people want to use this cross namespace. So they want to run some part of the web application in one namespace and the other component into other namespaces. So the problem here is that it's still there is no enforcement on the RBAC from the RBAC, so it's a still Ingress resource. So everybody can deploy it and use it. In the virtual server, virtual resources that we introduced, so we introduced two types, virtual server and virtual server route. And for the cross namespace, virtual server will be the master, and virtual server routes will be minions. And so, because the resources are of different kinds, here you can configure RBAC rules, so you can restrict the regular users. So you can allow regular users to deploy and virtual server routes, but you can disallow them to deploy virtual servers, and only privileged users inside the cluster can do that.
Thank you so much, Michael, and thank you for your time today. That was a wonderful talk. Everyone, give him a nice warm round of applause.